everybody. Dr. Rick Wallace dropping in on you. Checking in as I leave the office on the way home. See what's popping there. It's always going to be something on the agenda when I get there. Hey, that's what I signed up for, so I'm not tripping on it, but I'm headed home. Look, first, before I get started, I want to let you guys know about another new show. We still in the works of bringing back the Black voice. There are some organizational issues we need to get out of the way for that, because I don't want to do it with anyone other than my ace, Michael Jordan, and we're on two different sides of towns, and we can always do it digital, I mean in a digital way, but I think the chemistry works better when we're in the same room, and so we're still trying to work that out because he's busy, I'm busy, and to get together for 2 hours at the same time every week, we're working that out, you know, and we all have kids, and so they grab a lot of our attention and dictate a lot of our schedule, so we're working that out. But in the meantime, we are launching another new show on tomorrow. I would have loved to give you guys a more of a warning so you guys can prepare to tune in for the first show, which is going to be on the topic of incest. That elephant in the room that you've heard me talk about so much. What I'm more excited about is my co-host, who is also my business partner, and in one endeavor. And we both have a bunch of other things obviously going on outside of our partnership, but we've worked together to do some things for a few years now. And her name is Tiffany Banks, and she is a ball of lightning. One of the most caring and giving people I've ever met, but she holds no punches. She shoots and spits fire. And I'll give you a warning. Guys, if you don't want to be held accountable, this is not the show to tune into, because she is going to come for you. It's just who she is. I'm going to do everything I can to bring balance. I do everything I can to, you know, get her to chill sometimes. But when she's coming, she's spitting truth. She's just a person that's at a place of zero tolerance because of what she's experienced. And we're going to talk about some things in this show, which is going to be entitled Cries of a Nation. Now, we went back and forth between Cries of a Nation and Out of Darkness. And we decided Cries of a Nation. But we're going to be talking about a lot of the stuff that's swept under the rug, a lot of the stuff nobody wants to talk about, a lot of the things that are actually destroying us from the inside out on a daily basis. And we're starting tomorrow with something that's kind of hot, because I don't know what it is, but there was a post, I guess, that triggered it on my end. But I've been dealing with this thing for years because I counsel and consult young Black women and men, and that's an issue on both ends, women and men. This isn't just a female thing. It shows up, and it's more obvious in some of the outcomes, because children are born from these incestuous relationships, and so it's going to be crazy, and we're going to get into that. And so what I want to sort of talk about here today, sort of kind of lay out and set the mindset for tomorrow, is what are we going to do about it outside of finger pointing? Because we've become real good at finger pointing. We've become real good at blaming one another. The women blaming the men blaming the women, and we're not holding one another accountable. We are not taking action. The level of silent condemnation is breathtaking. Silent condemnation is the condoning of something by not speaking up, by not taking action, by simply sitting there. You're not saying it's okay, but you're not doing anything to show that it's not. And we have a lot of that in the community, not just in the area of incestuous relationships, but definitely across the board. Now, when it comes to relationships, this was kind of sparked by some recent events where this one girl posted a picture of her her five siblings, so it's a total of six girls, and it was crazy because she posted it and she had the pictures numbered 1 through 6 from the oldest to the youngest, and she named one Big Sis, but she also mentioned that Big Sis number one, she was number 5, and Big Sis number one was not just her sister, she was her mother. And Big Sis number 2 was also the mother of Little Sis number 6. And all of this kind of was sparked because the father just recently died like a couple of weeks ago. So now all of this is starting to come out. And we're still getting to the bottom of it. We're actually trying to get in touch with them. But what it did is it spawned a whole lot. I shared it because I wanted to point out the point that it's something that needs to be dealt with, and that we cannot consistently push it under the rug and pretend it doesn't happen and say we're healed. Saying you're healed and saying you're over it means absolutely nothing. You've got to go through a process of processing it. That's a traumatic event. Let me explain explain a little bit about how traumatic events actually traumatize us. Every traumatic event will not traumatize every person. Every person isn't easily traumatized. Some people are more easily traumatized than others, and that I'm not gonna get into all the ways that go about, but what happens when a person experiences trauma at a level that actually traumatizes them? What happens? Well, it makes an emotional and physical imprint. So it's not just a mental imprint, it's also an emotional and a physical imprint. And it imposes what is known as a traumatic memory. Now, traumatic memory is different than what you would know as a conventional memory. A conventional memory has been categorized and has been stamped in time. So when you have a memory of something, you know you are simply remembering it. You can sit up and you can decide, you know, man, that's not a memory I really want to dwell on. Or you can sit up, man, I remember this, and you can sit up and reminisce. With a traumatic memory, when it's triggered, it literally causes the person to relive it in the present. So it's never stamped. It has not been integrated into the time calendar of a person's mind. It hasn't been integrated into its normal memory system. So what happens is, until you are able to integrate the memory and actually qualify it as a past event, where now it's simply something that's recalled, it's not being recalled, it's being relived. And until you can do that, now there are some great techniques to use to help people integrate those memories, but until they are integrated, every time that this traumatic memory comes up, they relive it. They hear the same sounds. They smell the same smells. They have the same emotions. All of this goes through. They're literally in that moment, no matter where they're at. And that's a problem. You can't live life in a normal sense that way. You can't live life in a normal sense that way. So that's one of the first things, is there has to be a healing. And in order for there to be a healing, there has to be an acknowledgement of an illness, of a brokenness, of something that's not well. And we are great at pretending. We are great at normalizing. So we pretend we're okay, and we normalize dysfunction. So where we should be trying to grow and improve, we are now creating a pseudo culture of behavior and ideology around our dysfunction. And what that means is we've taken what's not normal, what's equitable in performance and in lifestyle and in behavior and in social structure, and made it our norm. We've made a pathology of suffering, a pathology of predatory behavior, a pathology of poverty and so much more our norm, our culture. And so now when people think about things, they associate things that have nothing to do with our blackness with us. Both blacks and non-blacks alike. There are certain things we do that's associated with us that's actually not a part of us. It's a part of our hurt, a part of our pain, a part of our dysfunction and a failure to heal. It's not who we are at the height of who we are. It's who we are in our brokenness. And we have been broken for so long and at such a great prevalence. It's not like we're talking about 5% of our population, not even 10, 15, 20, or 30. We're talking about probably over half of our population is in some way broken and traumatized, no matter how well we hide it, no matter how functional in our devastation and illness we are still ill. We are still not whole. We are still not living life at the level that we have the capacity to do if we become whole, and whole emotionally, whole physically, whole mentally, and most importantly, whole spiritually. All of these areas have to be in a state of homeostasis where we're operating in the same alignment, in the same movement, in the same state. You can be eating properly and exercising, but if you're stressed out mentally, you're still gonna have an imbalance which takes away from homeostasis and will cause illness in a body that you're in other ways treating quite nicely. You've got to understand, you've got to have a wholeness. You've got to be healthy in mind, body, and soul, and spirit. It has to be done. So we are going to start addressing a bunch of issues of topics that are swept under the rug. We're going to deal with domestic violence. We're going to deal with intimate partner homicide. We're going to deal with mass incarceration. We're going to deal with absentee fatherhood. We're going to deal with toxic mothers. We're going to deal with a bunch of different things that nobody wants to talk about. We're going to show in this that there's enough blame to go around. So blaming people isn't the answer. We're going to show that we need to really construct a system of healing, an environment that is conducive to healing. We need to do that, and we are going to address some issues head on. It's going to get heated. I just know that because I know my business. I call her my little sister. I know my business partner. She comes hard. I'm not sure how she's going to be approaching this, but I know her history and I know what she's done. I know how far she's come and just how passionate she is about it. I'm passionate equally, but I view and approach things from a lot more years of experience, first and foremost. She's a little younger than me, but I also do it. She's not that much younger because she's got adult kids, so she's not that much younger than me, but she's younger. But all in all, I think this is going to be a good thing. I think we need to talk about it. We need to initiate the process of healing. We need to be aware of where we are, and we need to change and reestablish a new baseline of what healthy looks like, because our healthy isn't healthy. It's not even close to being healthy. And we constantly look at stuff and we go, what the hell was wrong here? What happened here? Well, they weren't healthy. They weren't healthy, and everybody was pretending everything was all good. And then you get what happens when healthy people finally crack, finally break, finally just totally lose it. And you get all kind of crazy behavior that can go anywhere and cause harm to anyone, including themselves. And so we have to stop asking what went wrong, why this happened. Man, this don't make no sense. That's just pure evil. No, that's pure brokenness. That's pure desensitized brokenness. You want somebody to feel who hasn't felt in years. You want them to care when they feel like no one's cared for them. And then you want to sit up and say, well, you know, no matter what you've been through, you still, that sounds good. And it sounds reasonable and rational to someone who is not in that state. When you're in that state, you're not seeing things that way. And one of the things that I had to learn a long time ago, If I'm going to help people who are in certain dark places first of all, I can't be in that place. So that means I had to go through some serious cathartic processes in healing myself. And then what I had to realize in reaching out and helping these people is that I was going to be helping people who were not where I was, who were not thinking like I was thinking, who did not have the coping skills that I have, who can't process things the way I process it. And I was going to have to be patient. I was going to have to be understanding. I was going to have to lay down my mode of judgment and actually be able to help these people. That was going to be the case no matter what. And so, with that being said, I am looking forward to this. I'm excited about where the show, the teachers are going. You know, I'm putting all these things together, I'm producing, and there's somewhere I'm going with this. I want to increase the quality of production. I want to increase the engagement. I want to do a lot of things. But I want to touch topics from places of passion. And there are certain places of passion that are more focused with Dr. Blanchard and what we do with the teachers. And this is going to be really deep and in grimy with Tiff. And so, the hardcore go get it stuff is going to be where the Black Voice is going to end up, with the Black Voice radio show. So all of this is going to be a part of Rick Wallace Enterprise. All this is going to be a part of what we're doing with the Black Voice and, you know, and everything. But it'll be based and hubbed in this channel. And maybe at some point we spread out. I know we have a couple of podcasts going right now, and we're going to see how that goes with Spotify and things of that nature. But the goal is to really, truly reach the community. The goal is, and if you know me, you know that's a part of my MO. You know, that's how I move. That's how I operate. Yes, it needs to be productive because it needs to be able to, at minimum, support itself. I'm stretched thin as it is in providing resources for programs. But what the ultimate goal is, and if you know me, that's always been my, like I said, always been my MO with any channel you've seen. I'm not here for the sensationalism and the mass following, even though it would be very, very financially advantageous. It would not be what I'm looking to do. What I'm looking to do is find the people who really are looking for substance, who are looking for what it takes to be a difference maker, what can change the world. And what I can tell you is I've gotten so many Black women who have brought their sons to me. And another Black woman, after that post about that relationship with that man and his daughters, another woman came on there and she was triggered by the post. You know, now with her situation, it was a little different. It wasn't, she wasn't a victim of it, but she found out that her ex, who wasn't her ex at the time, was having an incestuous relationship with his biological daughter, which wasn't her daughter. Now, the child that she has with him is dealing with this, and on and on and on. And I don't want to say too much, but those people need help. Those people need help. And we are in a place where they actually are out there alone without help, without any way to sit up and reach resources, because either they can't afford the resources, or because the resources aren't there, because they're not accepting certain insurances. And one of the problems that I've had is, like I said, I get so many people that bring in sons to me that are coming to me, and it's male and female, but there are a lot of moms bringing older teenage boys and young men in their 20s and saying, hey, this is what's went on. This is what happened. I don't want my mistakes of choosing or to be in relationships that weren't productive to be a lasting impact on them. Can you help? And that requires resources. And here, so we're here now trying to figure out how not to let any of these people fall through the cracks. And the scary thing is, they're probably going to be some, because I'm one person and it's hard to find people. One thing I need is a bunch of people who have mental health experience, counseling experience, and qualifications that can be assigned to some of these people who deal with special issues. Because we're not just talking about, you know, I had a bad day at work. We're talking about some of the things I just mentioned. We're talking about broken relationships, absentee fatherhood, addiction in the home, all of these things that have massive consequences. Because, you know, if you grew up in as a child, there are these things called adverse childhood experiences. Adverse childhood experiences range anywhere from being abused, and you can be abused in a number of different ways. Verbally abused, physically abused, sexually abused are the predominant ones that are measured and quantified in studies and research. You can also have neglect. You can also have environmental situations, which mean you're in a house with a parent who is gets incarcerated. You're in a house with a parent who has a substance abuse issue. Each one of these are a point. Anyone that you experience is a point. But we know that when a child has an ACE score of 3 or 4, meaning that they've experienced at least 3 or 4 of those things I just mentioned, and it's 10 predominant ones that are measured and quantified. And if they experience get a score of 3 or 4, it has negative implications as far as their lifetime outcome and results in mental health and physical health specifically. They're 12 times more likely to attempt suicide than a kid who has no ACEs. They are 4 to 5 times more likely to develop heart disease, 3 to 4 times more likely to develop diabetes. And these things are directly associated with it. It's amazing how things that seem to be only a mental emotionalism has the ability to impact so much of a child's future. And this is through the lifetime, of course, the lifetime. It doesn't wane over time. These are things that are going to have to be dealt with and coped with and processed to reduce the risk. And there are no programs out there that I'm aware of on a grand scale that are providing the services necessary to these children who are experiencing this, because there are a bunch of children experiencing this. How many kids you know have just grown up who had parents who were alcoholics? That's one right there. How many you know that had at least one parent in jail? Count all the other addictions too, especially kids coming up through that grew up during the crack epidemic. Okay, we can keep going. How many qualify as being abused in some form or another? We just talked about one way, CSA, you know, but there are so many other ways. Neglect, hunger, all these different things that they're dealing with are having a negative impact, and we're not dealing with it. And we're expecting broken parents to rear whole children. Not going to happen. With that being said, look, I'm excited about what we're going to do with these shows, but it's got to go beyond that. It's got to go to actually putting together resources. It's got to go to actually putting together programs. It's got to go towards actually making some things happen. You can't talk this stuff away. Now, you can educate it. I'm here to educate. I'm not here just to hear myself talk, because honestly, it wears on my voice. I am naturally a talker, but my God, you know, I'm talking all the time. I'm talking every session I have with clients. I'm talking all day. So trust me, I'm not on here to hear myself talk. I'm not on here just to say I said some things. And I don't have any need to prove what I know to anybody or to prove my intellect to anybody. I'm here because I'm hoping that I will inspire someone. I will encourage someone. I will empower someone. I will give them what they need to actually be a part of the solution. That's what it's about with me, solutions. We've got to create solutions, and that's not going to simply happen by sitting up, tuning in, and listening. We're going to have to get involved. On that note, I'm going to get out of here, and you guys have an unbelievable day.